Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome everyone to worship this morning, and especially our guest preacher this morning, Pastor Pat Esther. We will have additional announcements at the end of the service as usual. We'll proceed with the service.
Together.
We are the young and we are the old.
All people together.
Now is the kingdom and now is the day.
Gather us all people together.
Our gathering hymn this morning is ELW 532, Gather Us In.
Praise the lightest tree.
songs we raise. Glory be to Christ forever. Lamb of God and Lord of love, Son of God and gracious Savior, you have come from heaven above. On the cross you died to save us. Now you lay at God's right hand. Hear our prayer, restore, forgive us. In your promise firm we stand. Holy One, we now acclaim you. Lord, alone to you we call. Holy One, in faith we name you. God most high and dear to all. Jesus Christ, with God the Spirit, in the Father's splendor bright. For the peace that we inherit, glory be to God on high.
And together let us pray our prayer of the day, and let us pray. O God, our strength,
without you we are weak, wayward creatures. Protect us from all dangers, attack us from the outside. Cleanse us from all evil that arises from within ourselves, that we may be preserved through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
No! doing the right things this week to show God's love. First reading is from Deuteronomy chapter 4, beginning with verse 1 and ending with verse 9. The Israelites believed the law was a divine gift that provided guidelines for living out the covenant. Moses commands the people to obey the law and to neither add to nor subtract from it. The Israelites are also to teach the law to their children and their children's children. A reading from Deuteronomy. So now, Israel, give heed to the statutes and ordinances that I am teaching you to observe, so that you may live to enter and occupy the land that the Lord, the God of our ancestors, is giving you. You must neither add anything to what I command you, nor take away anything from it, but keep the commandments of the Lord your God with which I am charging you. You must observe them diligently, for this will show your wisdom and discernment to the peoples, who, when they hear all these statutes, will say, "Surely this nation is a wise and discerning people." For what other great nation has a God so near to it as the Lord our God is whenever we call to him? And what other great nation has statutes and ordinances as just as this entire law that I am setting before you today? But take care and watch yourselves closely, so as neither to forget the things that your eyes have seen, nor to let them slip from your mind all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from James chapter 1, beginning with verse 17 through 27. A letter of James was intended to provide first century Christians with instruction in godly behavior. Here Christians are encouraged to listen carefully and to act in what they hear, especially by caring for those least able to care for themselves. A reading from James. Every generous act of giving, with every perfect gift, is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave us birth by the word of truth, so that kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in the mirror, for they look at themselves and, on going away, immediately forget what they were like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious, and you do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God, the Father, is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and keep oneself unstained by the world. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
You may stand for the reading of the Gospel. The Gospel acclamation is found on 205. Bring you greetings this morning from Bishop Clemens and
was lamenting with another staff member the other day that since our work takes us to so many other congregations each weekend, our home congregations have probably forgotten about us. It seems like it just goes with the territory. So I'm glad to be home among all of you today. So thank you for having me. So I have a confession to make to all of you today. I have spent some time this week pondering the holidays. I know, it's not even September quite yet, with temperatures still hitting into the 90s, and I'm planning the holidays. But in my defense, I love the holidays, and my family has a great many holiday traditions I need to attend to. And I suspect my family is not unique in that. I would imagine many of you have traditions you follow from year to year, things you look forward to. For instance, every year I put up a really nice tree in our living room. And then I put up a kid tree down in our family room. It's that kid tree that warms my heart and I look forward to because it's decorated with every handmade ornament my children have made since they were 3 years old. And now, my grandchildren make them. And each year, they come to visit me, and we hang their handmade ornaments on that tree. I've been pondering, though, what this year will bring. Will it be like last year? Will we once again not be able to gather? Will the kid tree lack new ornaments again? Will the tradition be broken? I'm so saddened by that possibility. Perhaps you too have had to change your traditions this last year and a half, whether that be in your family or within the Lena community or here at Good Shepherd. And I don't know about you, but every ounce of my being is revolting against that reality. I want those traditions, by golly. I want to be able to do all the things I once was able to freely do, and I am less than thrilled about putting them aside. This last week, I happened to see an interview where two-time Olympic gold medal winner Abby Wambach, who played for the U.S. National Women's Soccer League. Abby is considered one of the finest women's footballers in the world, not just the United States, but in the world. And I got to see her play, and she is pretty amazing. In her interview, she was talking about the last World Cup tournament that she played in, and the U.S. had won that. And in her interview, she mentioned the fact that during the tournament, having come into it perhaps not at her best, her coaches pulled her aside, and after a couple games, they pulled her aside and told her they were going to make her a game changer, which in football is another way of saying that you're being sidelined. It means you're being benched. Abby recalls that she was absolutely stunned by that. She had been a starter for a very long time. She was used to being the reason they won games, a leader on the team, and was considered a mentor to the younger players. But here she was, being told she would be sitting on the bench. And in the interview, Abby recounts that event changed the trajectory of her life. Changed the trajectory. She recalls that after meeting with the coaches, that she went back to her hotel room and started pondering how she was going to respond to being benched. She knew she couldn't control the decision to be benched, but she could control how she responded to being benched. And she had a decision to make. Was she going to sit and pout, back away from helping with the younger players, create a lot of negative energy, and generally be a pain in the neck to the coaches, knowing, of course, full well that her attitude would have a negative impact on the success of the team? Or would she step up, cheer her team on, and continue to mentor the younger players and bring a positive energy to the tournament? In the end, she chose to be a positive force, and interestingly, in the interview, she credited that choice by making that choice that not only was it the major reason why they won the World Cup that year, but also that her attitude and decision paved the way for her success off the field after she retired. In fact, she is absolutely convinced that it was, and her coaches confirm that. She believes that her current very successful career is directly related to that moment in time, because she made the decision to put her teammates first above her own disappointment. In other words, she did the right thing by all of them. I think Abby is onto something. I do think that the choices we make have a lasting impact on our futures, how people see us, how they interact with us, and therefore they influence how our lives get lived out. In fact, I think that is where Jesus is going in today's gospel reading. In our story, the Pharisees are very concerned about Jesus and his disciples and their apparent lack of honoring the traditions of their faith, and they question Jesus. Obviously, by your question, we know that their traditions are of ultimate importance to them, and that they hold those traditions very high in their lived-out experience. So much so that Jesus reminds them that they are placing those traditions higher than God's command to love and care for their neighbor. Ouch. I don't know about all of you, but that is hard for me to read, because I too have been holding my family traditions pretty high these days. I'm lamenting having to set them aside during this pandemic for the sake of those who are vulnerable. In my heart, I know Jesus to be calling me to a higher way of being in the world, but it's hard, because honestly, I love my Christmas traditions. The truth is that there are so many things that all of us love that we've been asked to set aside, to sideline, to bench, if you will, in the last nearly year and a half. And like Abby, we need to make a decision as to how we are going to respond to that benching. Jesus is telling us to put our human notions aside and to think about our neighbors. And by neighbor, he means that term not in a geographical sense, but as a moral concept, as to how we see those around us, literally and more broadly, in our congregations, our community, state, nation, and throughout the world. Jesus is asking to put them first, to take on the Christian moral and ethical obligation to love and to care for them, especially the most vulnerable, before ourselves, before what we want, before engaging in our traditions. And here's the thing. The world is watching us Christians. They are waiting to see how we act. Because to most of the people in the broader community, we are suspect. Most of the people who live here in Lena and beyond, not only do they not attend church, but they don't because they believe us to be hypocrites. like Jesus called the Pharisees. They believe we say a lot about caring for the poor and the oppressed, the widow and the orphan, but then we act in ways and make decisions that are directly in opposition to that claim. We are more likely to want our traditions, our own way with things, than we are to care and love for our neighbor. We are more likely to insist that we don't need a mask or a vaccination, or that we can gather in large groups and ignore the recommendations of our healthcare professionals, or like me, trying to figure out a way to have all my holiday traditions than we are to care for others. And then we wonder why people don't want to join our congregations, why they don't want to be a part of our so-called Christian community of faith. We say one thing and do another, and therefore we become untrustworthy. Why should they believe us about God's love in Jesus Christ? Today, we are being pushed to think about our actions. When we've been benched, how do we respond? It's such a hard question to ask ourselves. The truth of the answer might be painful to come to terms with. We may be hearing Jesus' words, "You hypocrites." Boy, that's hard. But here's the thing. Jesus is calling us to a different way of responding than that shown by the Pharisees. Why? Because when we care for each other, when we extend that love by putting the most vulnerable ahead of ourselves, Jesus is promising us abundant life. When all of us who claim ourselves to be Christian act in Christ-like ways, our world changes. It becomes a marvelous place, a life-giving place where love abounds, where we thrive. All of us thrive. The truth is that there are going to be times when we are silent, when we're benched, just like we are being benched by this awful virus. But how we respond to that benching matters. It has a lasting impact on how we exist in the world. What we are being promised and reminded of in this gospel reading today is that God's love will be with us, even as we've been benched, even when things get hard. Because of God's love, we can set aside our traditions, set aside our need to have our own way for the sake of the other. Because of God's love, because we have been called beloved, we can make the right choice and choose to love those around us so that all people, everyone, may know God's love by how we do care for our neighbor. Amen. Our hymn today is 865, please.
Together, let us confess our faith using the Apostles' Creed. You'll find that on page 105. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ,
God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified by God, and was buried.
He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The congregation may respond to each petition of hear us, O God, with your mercy is great.
From our homes and our assemblies, indoors and outside, we join together in prayer for new life in the church, new hope for the world, and God's love for all who are in need. We pray for the Church of Jesus Christ around the world. We pray for wisdom concerning church traditions. We pray for the pastor and staff of our congregation, Pastor Nico, Betty, Krista, Andrew, Jay, Sheila, Janice, Karen, and Tina. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for the well-being of the created earth. We pray for a halt to wildfires. We pray for peace throughout the world. We pray for nations experiencing adversity of any kind, especially Afghanistan and Haiti. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for our elected leaders. We pray for an end to prejudice. We pray for schools and Sunday schools, the students, teachers, school staff, and parents. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for those facing the coronavirus. We pray for orphans, widows, and widowers. We pray for all who are sick or suffering. We pray for those who are listed in the bulletin, and those who we name here before you, aloud or in our hearts, Mike and Louise, Cindy, Amber, Chris, Ron, Vicky, Kurt, and Larry. Abide with all in need of your grace today. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We give thanks for all the faithful departed, and we pray that at the end we join them in your presence forever. We pray for love, peace, comfort, and hope our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Again, I'd like to thank Pastor Pat for her presence, for her leadership, and her message this morning. Upcoming things we've got a Bible study on Tuesday morning. This evening, the Never Change Young Group will be having Bible trivia at 6:30 in the fellowship hall. We thank the Family Fun Day will be September 9th. Citizens State Bank parking lot for youth. We need helpers. That's actually for the whole community. Guess who?
Since the 4th.
Well, September 4th.
Did I say the 4th? Oh, no, one to four. 1 to 4 is the hours.
On the 4th.
On the 4th.
On the 4th, 1 to 4.
Yes. About we got anything else that I'm missing? Float making. We will be meeting at Donna Gullison's house September 6th, 1:30 p.m. We need help. If we don't get help, we won't get a float. It's as simple as that. The hospitality camp, where we will again be having a fall festival. Same thing with that. We need people to volunteer to fill the time slots. We will be taking up a collection of items for the food pantry, to donate to the food pantry, non-perishable items, as well as school supplies for the schools. God's Work in Our Hands, September 26th, same over that. I'm not sure, Joy, do we have any specific projects yet?
Not as of yet. We've got some small projects we can get accomplished.
Like I said, same way with that, we've got a growing list, but it needs to grow more down there on the sign-up sheet. Anything else, anyone else can, wants to announce? Hearing nothing, I think I'm done.
And so please accept this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.